Good morning, everybody. Happy Wednesday. We have an amazing show for everybody today. What do we have, Krystal?
We certainly do. We've got Zephyr Teachout on. She's going to talk about corruption, always a timely topic, and also anti-monopoly, so that'll be good. We've got Tim Alberta on, reporter from Politico. He took a trip down to Scranton to talk to the white working class folks there who shifted a lot from Hillary or from Barack Obama to Trump, what they're thinking about this election. So that'll be interesting as well. He got some great insights and quotes there. But we wanted to start with, did Politico accidentally tell us who Joe Biden is picking for VP?
Yeah, they might have given away the whole game here. So they have this piece. It's called Running Mate Rundown, Tracking Joe Biden's VP Pick. They basically have a list of all of the people within the article, and they're like, what she would bring to the table and what not. However, observers quickly saw, let's throw Mark's tweet up there on the screen, and we can see that what observers quickly saw is that they labeled her as Biden's running mate and that he chose on August 1st, which is 4 days from when that was published. And what really caught everybody's eye, Krystal, is there's a direct quote attributed to Joe Biden in the article saying
right.
that he decided on August 1st to take her. And I mean,
and that she's a worthy opponent and a worthy running mate was the quote that they attributed to the Biden team.
Yes. So this is a really big deal. I mean, there's a lot of speculation about what's happening.
Can you imagine, by the way, if you're the person who accidentally published this?
Oh, I feel so bad for them. So to Politico's credit, they said it was published in error. They
said it was a technical error.
A technical error.
Described it.
I want to understand how that works now. So just so everybody understands, the way a lot of stuff works in Washington and in the news business is something called an embargo. Right. So what happened is that news basically like the Department of Justice or something will have an announcement.
Yeah.
They'll give it out to every news organization with so you can pre-write it. So you pre-write your story and then they say you can publish at 12 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on this date.
Right.
And everybody has to wait for that embargo.
Right.
And there's always like jockeying. It's like, are they going to break the embargo first? Or are we going to break the
right.
embargo?
And sometimes they'll give it to just one news organization
as news
an exclusive and they can publish before the others.
Exactly.
All those things.
So there's all these games. Some people get earlier embargoes than others, etc. However, we don't know if that's what happened here, but
right.
look, this looks very suspicious. However, as we were talking about earlier, I find it incredibly hard to believe that the news is embargoed just because it would leak. There's just, it's
yeah.
one of the most tightly held secrets.
Right.
So I just don't, but again, I don't know how something like this happens. It's
I know.
Insane.
Well, that's the thing, like, because the other thing that news organizations will do, like if a prominent person is getting older or is
yes.
really sick, they'll like
right.
pre-write an obituary or they'll pre-write news like this
right.
that you know is, right, we know that an announcement is coming. So it's possible that they pre-wrote sort of templates mm-hmm. for each of the top contenders and then just accidentally published this one. The thing that threw everybody off, though, is that it's so specific,
right.
both in terms of the date and like, you know, we decided
to
jump the gun. And then
yeah.
the quote specifically
that's
attributed to him. That was the thing that everyone's like, I don't know if that's what you would do. So it's very intriguing. Also, this was interesting yesterday, too. We got a glimpse at Joe Biden's notes. And at the top of the notes, he has some things written here specifically about Kamala Harris and none of the other VP contenders. It says, do not hold grudges. So I guess that's something he needed to remember. Of course, I mean, politicians always write out different notes that they want to make sure that they get right when they are speaking extemporaneously. Nothing unusual about that. But the fact that she's the only contender mentioned there,
right.
and we covered here yesterday the fact that Chris Dodd, who's a close mm-hmm. Biden ally, seemed to, he was still upset about that debate exchange with Kamala Harris. He said she showed no remorse, right?
right?
And so it could be that Joe is just trying to kind of clean that thing up and expected that most likely she would be the person that he would get questions about. But again, it's kind of intriguing because why are you focused on this one person on your list of VP contenders instead of all the others?
Yeah, that's where I cannot get over that quote. I just can't, which is news organizations, as somebody who works in this business and you work in this, we do not just invent quotes. Nobody just writes up a quote, attributes it to them, especially to the Democratic nominee for president of the United States. It just does not happen. You don't
yeah.
pre-write an imaginary quote. Here's what is a possible explanation for what's happening here. The Biden campaign has given out basically blurbs and quotes for every prospective vice presidential nominee
yeah.
to major media organizations. I have no idea this even happened with The Hill. Obviously, there's like a wall between
yeah.
us. So it's possible that they've
let's
given
get,
like...
Let's get Bob in here and grill him.
Yeah, we should get him in here. But we have, it's possible there's like six different blurbs that they've given out. Let's say for Stacey Abrams, for Val Demings, for like Keisha Lance Bottoms, for Kamala, and for Susan Rice. And that they accidentally copy and pasted from that one. But again, I think they actually need to give us an explanation. Like Politico needs to give us a better explanation than a technical error. Because from where I'm standing, a major mass media organization just does not create a quote. I just know that they don't. Yeah. They do not attribute it to Joe Biden. I think they might have given away the game here. At the very least, if she's not the official pick, then it's a scenario that I'm laying out.
Right? Yeah. Oh, it's just such a massive screw up, though. And you're absolutely right. But it is weird, though, on the other hand, I think it's very unlikely that you would send this out to major news and put an embargo on it because I'm not aware of that ever happening before because this is the most closely guarded secret. You don't want anyone to jump the gun. You want to be out in front of it. You want to have it framed.
You know, the shock factor.
The shock factor. You want to be able to roll it out in exactly the way that you planned. So I don't know on this one, but I mean, certainly we know that Kamala is at the top, if not near the top of the list. So it is certainly very possible that we could learn that she is the VP nominee. And, you know, look, it's not that surprising. Clearly there's pressure on Joe Biden. Not only did he say he's going to pick a woman, but with the George Floyd protests, there's been a lot of pressure on him to pick a woman of color, a black woman in particular. I really think he was going in the direction of Amy Klobuchar before all of this.
I think she was a done deal. I agree. I think she was a done deal.
I really think so too. And then she smartly is like, I think it should be a woman of color after it was absolutely clear that it wasn't going to be her and kind of threw Elizabeth Warren under the bus. I mean, Kamala and her campaign, we played for you yesterday. What I thought was her strongest moment was actually when she was going against Joe Biden and landed that blow very effectively. But she really, let's not forget, she struggled in that campaign to capitalize on the mass amount of money on a very devoted, sort of hardcore but relatively small base. She had a lot of trouble in particular winning over people of color. I mean, African Americans, younger ones really overwhelmingly backed Bernie Sanders, older ones obviously overwhelmingly backed Joe Biden, giving him the nomination. And in particular, she struggled to explain her record as a prosecutor, really never effectively doing that. You will all recall this moment with Tulsi Gabbard at one of the debates.
I want to bring the conversation back to the broken criminal justice system that is disproportionately negatively impacting black and brown people all across this country today. Now, Senator Harris says she's proud of her record as a prosecutor and that she'll be a prosecutor president, but I'm deeply concerned about this record. There are too many examples to cite, but she put over 1,500 people in jail for marijuana violations and then laughed about it when she was asked if she ever smoked marijuana. She blocked evidence that would have freed an innocent man from death row until the courts forced her to do so. She kept people in prison beyond their sentences to use them as cheap labor for the state of California. And she fought to keep cash bail system in place that impacts poor people in the worst kind of way.
Thank you, Congresswoman. Senator Harris, your response.
As the elected Attorney General of California, I did the work of significantly reforming the criminal justice system of a state of 40 million people, which became a national model for the work that needs to be done. And I am proud of that work.
Something else that Tulsi didn't mention there is that there's a lot of questions about the way she dealt with Silicon Valley's very cozy relationship.
Failure
to prosecute Steve Mnuchin's bank for foreclosure fraud. And so she never in the campaign figured out how to handle that record. She never figured out how to talk about it. Now, let's be clear, like the criminal justice record that Tulsi lays out there is actually very consistent with Joe Biden's views. Mm-hmm. Very consistent. But in the campaign, she tried to paint herself as, you know, criminal justice reformer.
Progressive prosecutor.
And she was never actually able to marry those two things. And especially in this moment where there is such a focus on criminal justice, it creates a tension and an awkwardness there. She's going to have to figure out how to clean that up. You recall when she was asked about it again after the fact, she still had no answer for it. Instead, she went after Tulsi. She called her an Assad apologist who was polling at 0%, et cetera, et cetera. So that could be an issue for her.
Well, don't forget that she ended up polling herself at 3% nationally before she was embarrassed and bailed out of the race, bailed out and was like, no, you know, because she couldn't even win her own home state in California.
Yes, she didn't make it to Iowa.
Yeah, I just think it's crazy that you have a terrible politician, Biden. I mean, look, let's be honest. The guy barely won the Democratic nominee, right? And then, or Democratic nomination. And then you go back and you remember, I mean, we all lived it here live. Kamala's campaign was awful. She had so many different missteps. She didn't know where she was on Medicare for All. She was like, oh, I didn't hear the question. She had like three different instances where she claimed she didn't hear something. I remember so many. And just she slowly was just dwindling. And I remember the political press wanted her to happen so badly.
Yeah.
And they just couldn't grapple with the fact she just kept ticking down, 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 down. And then Bernie was rising up in like South Carolina and elsewhere. She was not able to capitalize whatsoever, despite getting all this money from Wall Street. I mean, Wall Street was in love with her for a little while. And she crashed and burned. You know, she completely did. So it's very bizarre, in my view, to pick somebody like her after her just terrible showing in the primary.
It's hard for me to see what she brings to the table.
Yeah,
I mean, there's not
a, bring California.
There's right. Yeah. She was gonna, and that's why she dropped down. She was going to lose her own home state. Didn't even make it to Iowa. There, you know, there were questions about the way the campaign was run, and also she was all over the place with a message. I mean, to me, that was really the thing. Is you recall she signed on to Medicare for All. She co-sponsored.
She's like a co-sponsor,
And she ran Facebook ads, building her own fundraising list off of the fact, like, I'm a Medicare for All supporter. I co-sponsored Medicare for All. And then the minute that the heat is on from the donor community about taking that stance, then it's totally different.
Yep.
Then she changes her tune. Then she can't hear the question when you're asked about private insurance. And that's kind of emblematic. Obviously, that issue is really important to me and really important to a lot of people. But that was kind of emblematic of the entire campaign. She's fishing around for a message. You know, every sort of season there was a new slogan for the campaign. Really never settled on how she wanted to run, how she wanted to talk about her record, what she wanted to embrace. Obviously, California is not like a critical swing state. So you're not bringing anything just from that like electoral perspective to the table. So, I mean, I think it's, for me, it's hard to understand what you really gain from picking Kamala Harris. Yes, she has a very devoted fan base.
On Twitter.
On Twitter. Yeah. But as we saw, it didn't amount to much in the campaign. I mean, it really amounted to a very small amount of the electorate. And those people are all 100% already voting for Joe Biden. So I'm not sure what it brings you to the table. But I do think that it is entirely possible, if not likely, that she will end up being the pick and that Politico really kind of like tipped the hand here.
Oops. Sorry, Politico. I feel bad for whoever screwed this
really,
up.
I really do. I'm dying to know what the backstory is, aren't you?
I'll make some calls. I'll figure it out. All right. We're going to tell you what's on our radars. That's next.